I've emphasized throughout this course that the classical theory of real competition is very different from the neoclassical theory of perfect competition. So when you say the word competition, I would like you to think of these as two different concepts, not something which is a little bit different. They're really fundamentally different. So from this point of view, I've tried to illustrate how you can apply the theory of real competition to the question of pricing and profits, to the question of imperfect and perfect competition, both of whom I argue are not the same as real competition. Neither one is. To the empirical evidence on markups and profit rates and concentration ratios and all of that. I also showed you how the theory of real competition becomes quite naturally separated into two components with a theory of commodity prices, inter-industrial prices, a structural component which reflects direct and indirect labor time, and a distributional component which reflects the differences in capital labor ratios and profit wage ratios across industries vertically integrated. And I showed you that that first component accounts for like 90% or more, maybe even 95% of the movements of actual empirical relative prices at any moment of time, cross-sectionally, and over time in the temporal. I then proceeded to extend that argument to the theory of financial assets and argue that you can explain the, you can derive a theory of interest rates from equalization of the bank profit rate with the normal rate of profit. I showed you that there's evidence supporting that equalization process. From there, you can derive a theory of not only the base rate, but all the term structure rates from profit rate equalization and the costs of longer loans being greater than the cost of shorter loans. I use this then to derive a theory of bond prices because bond prices depend on the interest rate. And that gives you a theory of the bond rate of return, which also depends on the interest rate. I also argued that the equalization of profits between the equity market and the real sector produces a theory of equity prices and therefore a theory of the relation between equity prices and the profit rate, just as the bond rate of and bank rate of equalization produces a relation between the interest rate and the profit rate. I then showed that all of these can be put together to explain the actual empirical patterns we have. So that is to say, it can explain things like Tuck's law, which is sometimes known as Gibson's paradox, because it shows that prices, that interest rates move along with prices, and that's paradoxical from the point of view of neoclassical theory, because it expects the interest rate to move with the rate of change of prices. If you remember, Fisher's hypothesis was that the real rate of interest is equal to some time preference structure, and therefore time preference rate of return, and that's given, assumed to be given over time. Therefore, the interest rate, nominal interest rate, will move opposite to inflation. The real rate, by definition, is the interest rate minus the inflation rate. If the difference between the two is zero, then if the inflation rate goes up, the interest rate must go up. But notice that the interest rate is following the rate of change of prices, not the movements of prices. So with that expectation, the finding that interest rates will follow the level of prices appears as a contradiction. And in neoclassical theory, no contradiction is ever admitted, but it is sometimes called a paradox. So whenever things don't work, you say it's a paradox. You don't think of the fact that the theory might be wrong. You think there's some problem in the concrete application of it. So now the last step in this path is to explain, to apply the same notion of real competition to the theory of international trade. And you can do that if you recognize and realize that international trade is just competition across nations. It's competition of firms across national barriers and national boundaries. And this is exactly the way Smith and Ricardo and Marx approach the issue of international competition. It follows, therefore, and I will show you, that you can then derive a theory of the exchange rate from this process. Because the exchange rate is, so to speak, the translator between domestic prices and foreign prices. And the theory of competition that I'm talking about will give you an implicit theory of the real exchange rate. And the real exchange rate is related to the nominal exchange rate by the price levels of countries. Therefore, we already have a theory of the relationship between the nominal exchange rate and relative inflation. And I will show you that this orders the actual empirical patterns. Instead of having a series of paradoxes, you have things that you see are perfectly reasonable and expected from the point of view of a different theoretical approach. Now, if this was a course in international trade theory, I could assume that you know all about trade theory and I can just go on to the real thing. But I can't make that assumption because international trade theory is structured in such a way that people often don't even understand what the argument is. So I want to lay out for you first the theory of international trade, its place in the overall story. It's obviously it's linked to globalization and uneven development and all of those issues. But let me start by making that key point that I just started with, which is that the theory of international competition, of real international competition, is an application of the theory of real competition. As such, it is as different from the standard theory of international trade as the theory of perfect competition is different from the theory of real competition. The same differences that we talked about will appear again, and they will also help us to explain the patterns we see without having to invent complicated exceptions, imperfections, asymmetries, and various other explanations of these paradoxes. First of all, to recognize that the theory of international trade is a critical part of the debates about the modern benefits of globalization of production and finance. You cannot talk about the world that we live in today. You cannot talk about what's happening in terms of employment and growth and even an uneven development and the movements of finance and the bubbles without understanding the underlying principles of international trade. And for that same reason, if you have the wrong principles, you will not be able to understand the patterns that you see as expected. You see them rather as paradoxes or deviations. So what are the patterns? First of all, the world is beset by widespread poverty and persistent inequality. This is just a fact which we've known for a long time, but it's important to put it up in front so that you understand that this is the backdrop. One of the things that we have to explain is how does international trade produce and reproduce poverty and inequality? For instance, the annual GDP per capita of the richest countries of the world is more than $30,000, while that of the poorest country is less than $1,000. That's a huge gap. But even that gap of 30 to 1, average of the developed versus average of the poor, is misleading because we know that the distribution of income within every country is highly skewed. I mean, we often hear discussions about the skewed distribution of income in the United States, but nothing compared to the distribution of income, the skewness of the distribution of income in Mexico, or Brazil, or Chile, or Argentina, or Indonesia, or Nigeria. So if you go across the world, looking at the per capita is a very dangerous mistake because it doesn't tell you a whole lot about the actual standards of living, since most people are below that because there's a small number who is way above it. According to the World Bank estimates, even at the beginning of the global crisis in 2008, so before the crisis came, almost half of the world's population of 2.1 billion people lived on less than $2 a day. And 880 million lived on less than $1 a day. This is the World Bank report of 2008. So this is before the crisis. Some developing countries have managed to advance despite these obstacles, but many others have not, and still others have slipped back in the global economic crisis. The solutions pressed on the world over the last three decades since the advent of neoliberalization by the developed countries, by the rich countries, and the institutions that they created and fund and support, like the World Trade Organization, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, have been to expand free trade. As Michael Moore, the former director general of the WTO says, I quote, "The surest way to do more to help the poor is to continue to open markets. That means in practice lowering tariffs and non-tariff barriers, reducing or eliminating subsidies, adhering to WTO rules on intellectual property rights, custom procedures, sanitary standards, treatment of foreign investors, especially important, and reforming existing tax structures and labor market rules to make them more market friendly. So the goal of these institutions is very clear: to spread markets and obviously therefore to spread capitalism. And the rationale for it is that free trade will make everybody better. And that's very important because that's a theoretical argument, not just a historical and empirical one. So it's important then to understand that the link between this practical policy and the trade theory is very deep. Neoliberalism, which is this policy of pushing free trade on countries and blocking other forms of international interaction, portrays markets as self-regulating social structures that optimally serve economic needs, efficiently utilize all economic resources, and automatically generate full employment for all persons who wish truly to work. Now, you recognize that immediately. That's basically the standard micro theory and macro theory of orthodox economics. From this point of view, poverty and unemployment and periodic economic crises in the world exist because markets have been constrained by labor unions, by the state, and a host of social practices rooted in culture and history, market unfriendly social practices. Overcoming poverty therefore requires market-friendly social structures in the poor countries and the process of strengthening existing social structures which are market-friendly in the richer countries. This involves curtailing union strength so that employers can hire and fire whom they choose, privatizing state enterprises so their workers will fall under the purview of domestic and foreign capital, and opening up domestic markets to foreign capital and foreign goods. This is the self-proclaimed task of international institutions, which is to oversee this process of moving the world towards a market-friendly and market-based institutional structure for the good of the poor. So this is not for the good of Donald Trump. This is for the good of the poor of the countries that these policies are being pushed. Now, this neoliberal globalization policies became a general policy during the 1980s, and they gathered force in the 1990s and continue to be dominant today. Yet, in most countries, this neoliberal era, beginning in the 1980s, was associated with increased poverty and hunger. This is a UNDP report in 2003. Of the 50 countries with the lowest GDP per capita in 1990, 23 suffered declines in GDP per capita, while the other 27 grew so modestly that it would take them almost 80 years just to achieve the level of Greece. That was in 2002, the level of Greece, which was at that time the poorest member of the European Union before itself went into decline in the current crisis. In Latin America and the Caribbean, GDP per capita grew by a total of 75% in the two decades before the neoliberal era, from 1960 to 1980, and then only 7% from 1980 to 2000 in the era of neoliberalism. In Africa, the first period, 60 to 80, yielded a total growth of 34%. In the second, per capita GDP fell by 15%. Only certain Asian countries escaped this pattern, and they did so, I would argue, by channeling the market mechanism rather than allowing it to do what it does. And we know some of those famous ones, like Korea and Japan, but there are others also that came up that way by interfering in the market, not just allowing it to do what it does. Finally, in this period of two decades of neoliberalism, international inequality also rose. In 1980, at the start of the neoliberal period, the richest countries had per capita had median incomes 77 times as great as the poorest. So the ratio of the median incomes of the richest to the poorest was 77 to 1 in 1980. By 2000, 1999, 2000, this had increased 122-1. Now this is not, and I will try and show this, because of the lack of free markets. This is because the move towards free markets creates inequality and unequal outcomes across the world. Now, in the discussion about international trade, nobody argues that countries should have no access to international resources. Rather, the debate is about how you have access. Do you do it by throwing yourself into a free market, opening up everything to market-sponsored and market-dominated things, or do you channel and control the free market the way you would a nuclear reactor, by making sure you can get the maximum benefit from it and the minimum cost? And there's always a cost, including the side effects. I want to first address the argument in favor of neoliberalism, the ones made by the proponents. Proponents of neoliberalism make a variety of arguments. They point, first of all, to the fact that the richest countries are market-based economies that have developed in and through the world market. We're talking of Europe here. We're talking of North America. We're talking of Australia and New Zealand, and subsequently Japan and Korea. They also point out that in standard economic theory, almost all economists, whatever their ideological position on other issues, I'm quoting, agree that international free trade is in the best interest of trading countries and the world. So you are very lucky, because you are in a one class where there's one of those other economists who argues that free trade doesn't work that way. If you were taking a trade course anywhere, and most probably even other places in this department, you would get the standard theory that says, well, free trade, if you have free trade, will give you all these benefits. And I'm going to come back to the question of how the heterodox tradition deals with these same phenomena. It has been pointed out that it is almost unanimous among orthodox and even heterodox economists that free trade leads to benefits for both nations and generally for people involved if you have competition. The proponents of neoliberalism also cite the empirical evidence to the effect that global poverty has been reduced since the 1990s and that trade liberalization has reduced poverty by fostering growth. And they argue that if some developing countries have not done as well as they should, it's because they have failed to implement sufficiently market-friendly policies. So from this neoliberal point of view, free trade would make the poor richer, would cause countries to grow more. And if countries haven't grown or have not become richer fast enough, it's because they haven't relied enough on free trade. They need more free trade. Now, on the other side, they're the standard critics. And by me standard, I mean most heterodox economists, but also progressive economists, such as Krugman and Stiglitz and many others, who are critics of the standard theory. And they say, first of all, that rich countries, from the old rich of the West, that is the Europe and the United States, and Australia and New Zealand, to the new rich of Asia, relied heavily on trade protectionism and state intervention as they developed, and that they continue to do so even now. So yes, they are market economies, but they're market economies that relied heavily on state protection and intervention in the market. These are the arguments by Agosin and Tusi, by Roderick and Hajun Chang. For instance, as far back as the 14th and 15th centuries, Britain promoted its leading industry, which was the manufacture of woolen goods, by taxing the exports of raw wool so that its competitors couldn't get the raw wool, and trying to attract away the workers from other European countries to England so that the competitors couldn't get workers to make the wool. In the heyday of its development from the early 1700s to the mid-1800s, Britain used trade and industrial policy similar to those subsequently used by Japan in the late 19th and 20th century and Korea in the post-World War II period. These were to channel development, to protect the local industry until it became strong enough to be competitive on the world market, and only then try to invade the markets of other countries with this developed country, developed industry. It was only when Britain was already the leader of the developed world that it began to champion free trade. And of course, this point was well known to Britain's rivals, which are Germany and the United States. And prominent thinkers in both countries argued that what we need in the beginning is protection of newly rising industries until they are strong enough to compete effectively on the world market. Indeed, even as Britain, by this time, the dominant power in the international market, and therefore now preaching free trade, even though it had not practiced it before, in the 1860s, after the 1860s, the United States was at that same time, literally the most heavily protected economy in the world, and remained that way until the end of World War II. In doing so, I'm quoting here Hajun Chank, quote, "The Americans knew exactly what the game was. They knew that Britain reached the top through protection and subsidies, and therefore they needed to do the same if they're going to get anywhere." Criticizing the British preaching of free trade to his country, Ulysses Grant, the president of the United States, Civil War hero and the US president between 1868 and 1876, retorted that, quote, "Within 200 years, when America has gotten out of protection all that it can offer, it too will adopt free trade." And that's pretty much right on schedule, by the way. If you think of the US policies in post-war period, beginning around the 1980s, US becomes a champion of free trade, which is roughly 200 years after the 1876 period of Ulysses Grant. And this is exactly what happens. We can tell similar stories of protection and state intervention for most of the developing world, including Germany, Sweden, Japan, and South Korea. Countries like the Netherlands and Switzerland that adopted free trade in the late 18th century did so because they were already leading competitors in the world market. Even so, the Netherlands employed, the Netherlands deployed an impressive range of interventionist measures up to the 17th century in order to build up its maritime and commercial supremacy. And Switzerland and the Netherlands refused to introduce a patent law despite international pressure until 1907 and 1912, respectively. This was so that they were free to take other people's developments without having to worry about restrictions on patent. These same countries are now going all across the world, hammering all the developing countries with the idea that you have to have protection of patents, you have to have protection of intellectual properties, and yet, of course, they routinely stole everything they could see and get their hands on. Publishers in England would know perfectly well that books made in England that were popular could be reproduced in the United States without having to pay any onerous fees because they could just be reproduced. This history of globalization is not just a matter of protection and state support as a means towards development in the West. There were also the small matters of colonization, brute force, pillage, slavery, mass slaughter of native peoples, and the deliberate destruction of the livelihoods of potential competitors. These are well known across history. Anyone who's read the history of the Third World knows how these practices operate. As Branko Milanović says, I quote, "Globalization was brought to many at the point of a gun, and many were globalized, literally kicking and screaming. Gunboat diplomacy of the West was central to its treatment of Japan, Tunisia, Egypt, Zanzibar, and China, among others. Millions suffered in slavery and near slavery on plantations all across the world, including, of course, in the United States and in Latin America. According to recent conservative estimates from 1865 to 1930, the Dutch East India Company pillaged between 7.4 and 10.3% of Indonesia's national income per year. Many other examples of this sort can be brought forward. Moreover, when you look at growth, it is not necessarily linked to free trade. Higher manufacturing growths have been typically associated with higher export growths, mostly to countries where exports and import shares grew side by side, but there's no statistical relation between growth rates and the degree of trade restrictions. Rather, instead, almost all successful export-oriented growth has come with selective trade industrialization policies. I mean, that's obvious from the history of England and Europe, of the United States, of Japan and South Korea, and now with China and many other countries. You can see that protection, state intervention, and channeling of the market have been very important to foster growth of the countries nationally and internationally. Stable exchange rates and stable price levels seem to be more important than import policy in producing successful export-oriented growth. And Danny Roderick, for instance, makes the argument that, quote, there are no examples of countries that have achieved strong growth rates of output and exports following wholesale liberalization policies. None. Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan are the classic examples of successful development through the application of highly selective trade policies. On the other hand, Chile between 1974 and 79, and Mexico between 1985 and 1980, then Argentina 1991, did follow wholesale liberalization, which not only wiped out the weak sectors, but also potentially strong ones, often at great social cost, which endured over a long period of time. Chile's economy grew by less than 1% per capita from 1973 to 1989. That's a neoliberal era in Chile. Mexico suffered similar setbacks and slowdowns in the neoliberal era. Argentina, which was celebrated as a good globalizer until as recently as 2002, ended up mired in deep crisis from which it recovered precisely by not following the rules, precisely by going against the rules and policies and advice of the standard economists and the international agencies. What is true is that economic growth is correlated with reductions in poverty in countries where the distribution of income remains stable. Well, that's reasonable. If the distribution of income remains stable and the country grows, then all boats are lifted by that tide. The trouble is that, generally speaking, the distribution of income does not remain stable. On the contrary, generally speaking, with growth, the distribution of income becomes highly skewed, so the benefits go much more to the top, and those at the bottom can even lose. And this is one of the things that, when you study development, you have to understand, looking at averages like GDP per capita is virtually suicidal, because you're missing the impact of people in the bottom, and those people are becoming increasingly active and angry about the conditions in which they find themselves for decades, if not half a century. On the other hand, there seems to be some evidence that reducing poverty improves growth, which is different from saying that you get it from the trickle-down effect. This is saying acting to reduce poverty can raise growth. So the high correlation between poverty and growth reduction does not tell us a causation, and it certainly does not guarantee that growth will produce reduction in poverty. Furthermore, from the very beginning, there was considerable evidence that opening up economies to the world market, and especially to rapid movements of financial capital, leaves a real exchange rate at the mercy of short-term capital movements, so that even small change in the direction of trade and capital flows can produce large swings in real exchange rates. You get the magnifier effect because these monies come rushing in and they come rushing out, and they have a big impact on exchange rates, on real exchange rates. It also means that the domestic interest rate is now linked to the world market, because capital flows from where the interest rate is low to where it's higher, and these flows means that you cannot keep your interest rate as an independent policy variable. It becomes something tied to the world market. Finally, the current global crisis can be traced to global financialization, which was part and parcel of neoliberal policies, and has left a trail of economic unevenness and economic devastation in many parts of the world. Critics of modern globalization therefore conclude that trade liberalization imposed on developing countries has actually led to slower growth, greater inequality, a rise in global poverty, and recurrent financial and economic crises. They blame the WTO, the IMF, and the World Bank for their cruel and inept actions in the face of such miseries. And that includes people like Stiglitz, who made exactly that argument, that their actions were cruel and inept. Such sentiments have become so important and so loud these days that even the agencies themselves are beginning to admit that they have problems in the way they approach these. Stiglitz's damning critique of the WTO and IMF continues to have a big impact on the world. And most recently, even the IMF has begun to concede that despite the rosy predictions of its theoretical models, and a very important point, buttressed by standard economic theory, the theoretical models, the empirical evidence leads to the opposite conclusion, that there is no proof in the data that financial globalization has benefited growth in the developing countries. Now, this is the IMF. This includes Prasad and Rogoff and others writing from the IMF side. So here you have historical evidence of how countries got rich by intervening and shaping and structuring their interaction with the world market, as well as the development of internal industries. We have evidence of how neoliberalism has very uneven effects, and in some cases very negative effects, so much so that even the IMF is willing to concede that things have not worked out as they planned. So then what's the problem? The problem at this level seems to be one about the difference between perfect and imperfect competition. Because the standard models are based on perfect competition, and if they don't fit the world, and they do not fit the world, then the logical pathway seems to be to say that it's because the world is imperfect. So we have different ways, different attempts to modify the standard model by bringing in imperfections to make it fit. And that is, as I've argued, is the standard approach of not only orthodox economists, but almost all, without exception, heterodox economists. All the post-Keynesian economists operate in this domain, modifying perfect competition in a variety of ways to a theory of imperfect competition in order to make it fit some phenomena. I've argued that this is wrong, that it's a mistake for heterodox economists to fall into the trap of thinking that the world would work a particular way if there was competition. They need to step back and rather ask, how does competition actually work? And I think then you will find, and I'm going to argue today, you will find that the patterns you see are the patterns you should expect, because that's how competition works. It benefits some and it harms others. So the purpose of my lectures in the next couple of lectures is to demonstrate that the conventional Ricardian theory of free trade is wrong on its own ground, and the ground is the ground of competition. It's wrong because real competition gives a very different result to exactly the same theoretical question than perfect competition. From this point of view, it's not the real world that is imperfect because it doesn't fit the theory, but rather the standard theory that is inadequate to the world it pretends to analyze. Indeed, from the perspective of the classical theory of what I want to call competitive advantage, not comparative, but competitive advantage, which is real competition, globalization has been working as should be expected. That is, you are seeing what you should have expected, which is to say that globalization favors the developed over the developing, the rich over the poor, and those portions of the developing world that can enter the world market in a competitive position, possibly because they've been built up over time, as we saw in Japan and South Korea, and now in China, by the way. To then address this issue, I want to go back to standard trade theory. I want to show you how trade theory gets from the idea of perfect competition to the idea of comparative advantage, comparative cost, and from comparative cost to the idea of comparative advantage, like the Heckscher-Ohlin-Samuelson model. These are linked, and they're linked to their root, which is the theory of perfect competition. Conventional free trade theory tells us that trade and financial liberalization would lead to increased trade, accelerated economic growth, more rapid technical change, vastly improved allocation of national resources, away from inefficient import substitutes towards more efficient exportable goods. You know, the whole argument against import substitution came from this idea that exports is a more efficient use, and so therefore we should do away with import substitution and get everything we need on the world market. All of these conclusions can be derived from the structure of neoclassical theory and the theory of perfect competition. Now, neoclassical economists admit that the process of adapting to free markets or introducing free markets might initially give rise to negative effects. For instance, if you open up your country to free trade, some of the sectors in your country which are not competitive in the world market will lose business and may shrink and may even go out of business, in which case unemployment will rise. But these consequences are viewed as strictly temporary and should be addressed by appropriate social policies until the benefits of free trade take hold. Why? Because in standard economic theory, unemployment is purely temporary. If you have unemployment, then that's because wages are higher than they should be. And that means that unemployment will bring wages down if you don't interfere. If those horrible things like unions and the state don't interfere, wages will come back down, and that will mean more employment and so you're back to full employment. From that point of view, opening up the country to the free market, eliminating to the world market, elimination of trade protection, the opening up of financial markets, and the privatization of state enterprises are all mechanisms to bring you back into the golden land of the free market, and therefore to improve growth, standard living, and reduce poverty. Now, all of these conclusions can be shown to derive from two premises only. First, that free trade is regulated by the principle of comparative cost, not absolute cost. Very important, Ricardo's great contribution to this whole discussion. And secondly, that free markets will produce full employment in every country. Now you can see why the two come together. If you have free trade and it has some damage that causes unemployment, then you can't say that the benefits of free trade, whatever those are outweighed by the cost of unemployment. But if you can say that free markets will give you full employment, then of course you don't need to worry about the temporary disadvantages of opening up a country or changing patterns of trade or whatever. So this brings me then to the key point for this lecture, which is the theory of, which is the principle of comparative cost. Most often, when you get the principle of comparative cost, it's presented as the proposition that a nation, quote unquote, would always stand to gain from trade if it were to export some portion of the goods it could produce comparatively more cheaply at home, and exchange those for goods it could get comparatively more expensively abroad. And the emphasis here is on comparative. So nation is told, or we are told, that the purpose of trade is that the nation should focus on producing and exporting goods which are comparatively cheaper at home, and importing those which are comparatively more expensive home. Now, implicit in this argument is that somebody has to be doing this. And of course we know that trade is not taken by nations, it's undertaken by firms. So implicit in this argument is the claim that the market will bring this about. The market will bring about countries exporting goods in which they have a comparative advantage, comparative cost advantage, and importing goods in which they have a comparative cost disadvantage. Now, I emphasize the word comparative. It doesn't mean that you'll import goods that are cheaper. Only goods whose relative advantage is in your favor, even though they may be cheaper abroad. And that's a key question. How is that going to come about? Now, before I go into this, let me just say one point which I emphasized several times in previous lectures. In the trade literature, when they say cost, they don't mean cost. They mean price of production. They mean cost plus a normal profit. You remember I pointed out to you the neoclassical theory, the cost curve, is not a cost curve. Average cost, including cost of materials and wages and depreciation, plus a normal profit rate in the form of a markup that gives you a normal profit rate. So it's not average cost, it's actually average price of production. So when they use cost here, they mean it in the neoclassical sense of a price that guarantees you a normal profit rate. This is different from the term cost in Smith and Ricardo and Marx, which is the cost of production, which doesn't include profit. It's raw materials, wages, unit labor costs, materials costs, and depreciation. No profit involved. So I have to point this out because much of the literature talks about comparative cost, meaning price. And then when we get to the classical literature, we'll talk about costs, and we mean costs. So I'll try and warn you. The key thing to understand is that once you know that nations don't trade, but firms do, then you have to ask yourself, how do exporters and importers traveling or interacting across the whole globe come about to this conclusion, to this result? So the starting point usually is to trick you into believing that free trade will make everybody better off. And here's a standard way you do it. I have a nation that's this half of the room. I have another nation. Consider these nations as people. Well, you wouldn't trade with them unless you could be better off, especially if you knew what you were doing and you had perfect knowledge. So you would only trade if you gained. And they wouldn't trade with you unless they were better off. Therefore, if there is trade, it follows that you're better off. There's a standard trope of the theory of exchange in neoclassical economics. The famous Bowley-Edwards box diagram, where you trade, one person trades, another person trades, and everybody ends up on a locus of mutual gain. The trouble, of course, is that nations are not people. And in fact, trade is not conducted by nations except when they intervene in the free market. It's conducted by the market. And the market consists of traders, exporters, importers, domestic producers, non-traders, and so on. So here you have to make a different argument, which is that the multitude of individual firms operating in their own self-interest, a profit-making interest, will produce the result that each nation will gain from trade. And clearly, to do that, you have to go from the micro to the macro. You cannot just jump it. And the key point in the standard theory is that free trade will make each nation equally competitive without it having to do anything about its efficiency or wages, without having to do anything about its cost structure. If you just believe in free trade, then even if you have high costs, you're a backward country in terms of competition, you will nonetheless survive and in fact prosper because you'll end up with a set of goods which will give you enough exports for you to cover the imports that you buy. Your trade will be balanced automatically through some magical mechanism which I'm going to be talking about shortly. And the person who produced that argument is Ricardo, so we need to go back to Ricardo. But that's not enough. That's one half of the story, that somehow trade will be mutually self-balancing so that whatever you export will be equal to whatever you import. Trade balances will be zero on average. They'll be fluctuating around zero. The second one is that there's automatic full employment, because otherwise any adjustment process may lead to persistent unemployment. So you need that part of the story also. I'm going to repeat again a little bit about the issue of what the difference is between comparative cost and comparative advantage, because those are often confused. The principle of comparative cost really boils down to the proposition that the terms of trade of every nation will move so as to make trade balance between nations. And we're going to come back to how that mechanism is. It'll move to make trade balance between nations. Each nation will then find will export the goods in which it has the greatest comparative cost advantage. In other words, its costs are relatively lower for those goods and relatively higher for another set of goods. So it exports the ones with the relatively lower costs and imports the one with the relatively higher costs in such a way that trade is balanced. That means that if you open up trade between countries with different efficiencies and different wage structures, the principle of comparative cost says that nonetheless, both countries or all sets of countries will end up with balanced trade. So that competitiveness does not matter. Efficiency does not matter. Wages does not matter. Wages do not matter. So these two assumptions, comparative costs and full employment, are then built into the next stage of the argument, which is, okay, suppose I accept the principle of comparative costs. So this part of this nation is trading in, is exporting wool because wool is relatively cheaper compared to steel in this nation, even though it's cheaper in both here, it's relatively cheaper here. And here steel is relatively cheaper. So they're exporting wool and they're exporting steel, and they do so in such a way that they trade balances. Then the question becomes, why is wool relatively cheaper here and steel relatively cheaper there? And that's the Heckscher-Ohlin-Samuelson question. Accepting the principle of comparative costs, accepting that trade is balanced, what explains the relative what explains the comparative cost patterns? And the answer is, it depends on the endowment of factors. If the country exporting steel is very capital intensive, and steel is a capital intensive good, then under the standard assumptions, it will have a lower relative price in steel. And if the country exporting wool is land intensive or labor intensive, and wool is a very labor intensive activity, then this country will end up exporting wool. So, translating it into development, underdevelopment, each country should specialize in what it does well. That is to say, if it has a lot of land or a lot of labor, it should specialize in land-intensive and labor-intensive goods. And those countries that are capital-intensive would be specializing in capital-intensive goods. That's a prediction of the Heckscher-Ohlin model based on this argument. I'm going to come back to it, but that prediction always fails. It works 50-50. That is to say, it works about as well as flipping a coin. And that's well known. I'm going to go through that literature. It sounds like a plausible argument only if you heard it repeated many times. Otherwise, it really isn't plausible, because the issue is relative prices, not absolute. That's a key point. Secondly, in Heckscher-Ohlin model, further comes the further thesis, under certain conditions, that you get factor price equalization. What does that mean? Without the mobility of capital or labor, the movement of capital intensities in each country along their production function or isoquant production possibilities frontier will bring you to a situation where wages in both countries will be equalized and profit rates in both countries will be equalized. Why? Because it's assumed that there is the same technology in both countries. This flexible production function technology is assumed to hold in both. Therefore, the wages will end up being equalized through the movements of capital labor ratios, and these are standard derivations of the Heckscher-Ohlin model, so that without having to move labor or capital, you'll get equalization of wage rates and profit rates across countries. And that's called the factor price equalization theorem. I don't have to tell you that you don't have to look very far to see that that theorem doesn't work. Look at wages across the world. Look at wages across country, even in one country. Look at them between the United States and Mexico, and you will see these huge gaps. Now, they would argue that's because there's not enough competition in Mexico, not enough free trade, because if it did, then these factor price equalization theorems would work. I'm going to argue just the opposite. The theorems are false. They never worked, and they wouldn't work even if countries become more market-friendly, because the actual outcomes will be based on a different theoretical structure. So we know that to summarize, there are three propositions that are essential to trade theory, standard trade theory. One is the terms of trade will fall when a country runs a trade deficit. Why? Because if the terms of trade fall, that means exports will rise because your exports will be relatively cheaper. Terms of trade are exports over imports in common currency. If your terms of trade fall, your exports are becoming relatively cheaper. More people will buy your exports. Leaving aside questions of elasticities and all that, presumably your export volume will rise. Similarly, your imports will become more expensive, so you'll buy less of imports. Presumably, your import volume will fall. So therefore, if you have a trade deficit, your exports rising, imports shrinking, will mean your trade deficit will disappear and you'll end up at balanced trade. Everybody follow that? Should I do that again? Okay. Suppose that a country here has a trade deficit, so it has selling fewer exports than it is imports. So the exports are 10,000, but it's importing 20,000, right? If this leads automatically to the terms of trade falling, that means in the foreign market, in the world market, exports will become cheaper, so people will buy more exports of yours, so that export production will rise here. On the other hand, here, imports will become more expensive, so you'll buy less imports. Leaving aside the elasticities problem, you can see that you are moving. You have imports bigger than exports. Now exports are beginning to rise. Imports are beginning to come down. If it all works out, it'll balance when they're equal. If it goes too far the other way, then the terms of trade will move in the opposite direction. So it's an automatic self-balancing mechanism. That was Ricardo's great contribution, the argument that free trade is a self-balancing mechanism for international trade because of this movement of terms of trade. I'm going to come later to how he comes about that. That's the first argument, first step in the logic of the standard trades. Terms trade fall when a country runs a trade deficit. Second is that the balance of trade will improve when the terms of trade fall. That second one doesn't follow automatically from the first. And this is known as the elasticities problem. Think about this. Here you have a country whose exports have become cheaper. So people are buying more of the exports. But they're buying it at a cheaper price. So will the value of exports go up or down? That depends on the elasticity. Right? If they don't buy enough to compensate for the cheaper price, then even though you're selling more exports, you're making less money. Same thing for the imports. If the price goes up, you'll buy less. But because the price has gone up, the sellers are making more money per good, so they may actually end up making more money than when the price was. So if the terms of trade don't have sufficient elasticities, then it will not lead to balanced trade. And this is known as the elasticities problem. I'm going to argue it's irrelevant, but for the standard theory, it's fundamental. Okay? Is that point clear? So that's point number two. Point number three. None of these adjustments, which are continually going on because new markets come in and old goods go out and export today is not the export of tomorrow, can cause unemployment because you assume continuous full employment in every country, or at least rapid full employment. Because otherwise, you can see that all the stuff about benefits of free trade and all that fall down to the ground if it leads to unemployment in some countries. Because of that, I'm going to deal with the criticisms, the empirical and historical criticism of these three propositions. First proposition, terms of trade fall when there's a trade deficit. Second, the elasticities are such that the balance of trade improves when the terms of trade fall. And third, all unemployment problems are quickly eliminated by the workings of the free market, especially the labor market. So let me begin with the first one. Is it true empirically that we have full employment on a world market. Well, it's obvious that that's not so. The International Labor Organization, the ILO, reports that as much as one-third of the world's workforce of 3 billion people is unemployed or underemployed in the early 2000s. And of course, after the crisis, it became worse. In the developed world, even in the developed world, prior to the world crisis, the unemployment rates ranged from 3% to 25% across countries. Spain, for instance, was 25% prior to the crisis. Of course, in the developing world, things were often much worse. There were 1.3 billion unemployed or underemployed people at the start of the 21st century, many of them with no prospects of reasonable employment in their lifetime. It doesn't take a whole lot of reflection to recognize the linkage between unemployment and poverty, persistent unemployment and persistent poverty, which has characterized so much of the world. So, not surprising that people who look at standard trade theory begin by first rejecting premise number three, that there's automatic full employment. In fact, they reject it even within the developed world, and that is traditionally the Keynesian and Kaletskian wings on the heterodox side, as well as orthodox economists who talk about wage rigidity and price rigidity and various rigidities that are bringing, that can cause unemployment, which hopefully can be removed so you can go back to full employment. So there is, among heterodox economists, this is a point of attack. What do you mean full employment? Keynes didn't say that full employment was automatic. You have to produce full employment, okay? I'm gonna argue next semester, by the way, that you cannot produce full employment, but that's a separate story and I'm gonna come to that later in the macro section of this course. The second argument, going in reverse order, is that when the terms of trade fall, the balance of trade will improve. This is, of course, the elasticities problem. And there's a huge number of studies saying that it cannot be taken for granted that a fall in terms of trade will improve the balance of trade. And this is one way. You can always get a paper published. Just look for a new set of data and test the elasticities. And you're dealing with a literature which is huge and well-developed, trying to attack this second linkage in standard theory. And the last point, which is the first in the set of three, is that the terms of trade will automatically fall in a deficit country if it's left for the market to continue. Now, if you think about it, what this really says is the terms of trade is the export. I'm so thrilled to find chalk. In the other class, I had to run out and go for three classes before I found chalk. The terms of trade is the exports in the local currency, imports in the domestic currency. Let's say that that's the euro. And then, of course, they have to be converted into common currency, so you need an exchange rate there, right? So if your exchange rate is dollars per euro, then this is the terms of trade. Exports in dollars, if you're the American, from a US point of view, imports in euros times the exchange rate. Now, of course, it's never that simple. You have a basket of imports, you have a basket of exchange rates, but the point is the same. It's the dollar in terms of the international currency, whatever it is, that's your reference currency. But notice that this is simply 1 over the real exchange rate. So this terms of trade is a reciprocal of exchange rate defined one way. Obviously, if I define the exchange rate the other way, then I can Everybody see that? I mean, if I define the exchange rate as euros per dollar, then you don't have an exchange rate here. And then this term here becomes terms of trade is directly equal to the real exchange rate. It depends. You have to be always careful in textbooks to keep track of how the exchange rate is defined in terms of the foreign currency versus yours or your currency versus abroad. If we do it this way, then you can say that the real exchange rate, which is the terms of trade. So this is the real exchange rate is the same thing as the terms of trade. Here, deflated by export-import prices. Now, I can define other real exchange rates. I could put in here tradable goods and importable goods. It depends on when you have the data for. But the point is that basically you're talking about movements of real exchange rates when you're talking about terms of trade. Everybody with me here? Now this proposition, which is the number one proposition that I started with, is that the real exchange rate will fall in a country that has a balance of trade deficit. And it'll do so in such a way as to make the trade deficit disappear. And that's the punchline. Putting all three of these arguments together, the punchline is between the two countries, exports and imports will be roughly equal. And therefore, we would expect, I'm quoting here, the expectation is that on average over a decade or so, ebbs and flows of competitive advantage would appear random over time and across countries. In other words, trade would be roughly balanced except for some random fluctuations, and we'd expect to see that. That's the fundamental expectation of standard theory, and it is everywhere falsified, which is why there is a huge literature trying to explain why it's not true while still maintaining all of the assumptions by bringing in imperfections. I mean, that's a standard way. You bring in some imperfections. This proposition has never been empirically true in the developing world. It has not been true in the developed world, not under fixed exchange rates in the Bretton Woods era, not true after flexible exchange rates came in after the Bretton Woods era died. On the contrary, persistent imbalances are the signature of international trade. Balance of trades are not balanced, are not zero, but definitely positive or negative for long periods of time. This is obvious in developing countries who often have to struggle with balance of trade deficits, at least in some parts of the world. But it's surprising, surprised to people studying the developed world that it's equally true in the rich world. For instance, for most of the post-war period, beginning really in the 1950s, early 60s, the United States has run a trade deficit, and it continues to run a growing trade deficit all the way through to the present. And Japan, on the other hand, has run a trade surplus. And so this is not a temporary fluctuation here, talking about a structural difference. And we're going to look at that data shortly. You can see data of this. You can see these same patterns for all the other OECD countries. When you come to the Heckscher-Lean theory, which relies on the assumption of comparative costs, plus the idea of factor endowments determining the comparative costs, you find that the Heckscher-Lean theory not only has all the difficulties of the fact that comparative cost theory doesn't work, the comparative advantage part doesn't work either. In fact, it works so badly that roughly 50% of the time it gives the wrong prediction. One of the assumptions of Heckscher-Lean theory is that technology is the same, and it's well known that technology is not the same. The whole thing about development is to catch up, to make the technology similar. Real wages remain persistently unequal, even across developed countries, and it's certainly much more unequal across developed and developing countries. This is so well known in trade theory, in empirical parts of trade theory, that the theory doesn't work at any level on its own, that it's been acknowledged, I'm quoting now, it is acknowledged among experts that the persistent failure of the most fundamental propositions of trade theory has undermined confidence in its whole structure. Well, yes, I can see that. If the theory has always been empirically wrong, in any broad sense, it doesn't work, you can see that the confidence would be undermined. So then the question, the natural question is, where is the problem? What is the difficulty? We know that it doesn't work in the way it should. And the two general answers, the ones that are accepted in the profession, heterodox and orthodox, are the ones I'm going to argue against later. But for now, I want to put them on the table. The two types of reactions to the intrinsic historical problems of standard trade theory. First is that the predictions of standard trade theory are meant to be long-run predictions. And in the long run, we need enough data to make the long run feasible. For instance, it might take one set of people have argued, Fruit and Rogoff, for instance, and Rogoff later in 1996 argue in the International Encyclopedia of International Economics, that it takes a long time to be able to distinguish between a stationary real exchange rate, which is predicted by purchasing power parity theory, and I'm going to come to that, and a path-dependent one generated by a unit root process, which could have trend. But you need at least 70 years. So we can't say yet whether the theory is false because we don't have data spans of 70 years. So of course, if you have 70 years in which you can be on either side, you have plenty of room to publish from either point of view because the time may take care of one or the other. In the meantime, you have to get publications and get 10 years. So you need to write your articles now, pick a side, and keep writing. Everybody, therefore, a huge number of models that fill in the gaps by saying, OK, I'll take this proposition and I'll make it imperfect. I'll take the other proposition and make it imperfect. I'll stick in sticky wages, sticky prices, exchange rates that are being interfered with, interest rates that don't behave properly, whatever. And I can build a model that explains some pattern. The problem is that these models contradict each other, because they're all local deviations from the standard theory. And what you twist in one part has implications in another part that contradicts something else. But people don't pay attention to that. They focus on showing that these so-called small models work in some local area for a while. And then they cease working also. Most of these models not only contradict one another, but they contradict other aspects of the reality different from the ones they're pretending to explain. So that even from the point of view of people who believe in a standard theory, for instance, Stein, he says, I quote, "The evaluation of these contemporary models show why economists have been so disappointed in their ability to explain the determination of exchange rates and capital flows. The difficulties of standard theory become so acute that, I quote, neoclassical economists have expressed increasing frustration over their failure to explain interest rate movements, despite the fact that this is one of the most well-researched fields in the discipline. Not a single model or theory has tested well. The results have been so dismal that mainstream economists readily admit their failure." This is an article by Harvey in 1996. "Yet, as Will Milberg points out in 1994, the notion of comparative advantage continues to dominate thinking even among economists. These failed models, quote, continue to be offered as a dominant explanation of exchange rate determination, even though most scholars are aware of the deficiencies of these models. Worst of all, these same models continue to have a major influence on economic policy, having provided the underpinning for the policies of the IMF and the World Bank." And this brings me back to the point I made about the IMF admitting that the world didn't behave the way their models said. Well, their models are these models. They're foundationally based on these standard theory. So the first reaction is, well, I know it doesn't work. It must be something we haven't waited long enough. Perhaps if we wait, things will sort out and the patterns will come true. The second reaction is, of course, the imperfections reaction, which is, okay, we can take all the lists of assumptions and we can torture a few of them until they give us a different result, and then we can say, look, we've got a new model. So we look at modifying competition to allow for imperfect competition, modifying factor mobility to allow for restricted mobility. Returns to scale can become decreasing returns to scale. For instance, new trade theory, of which Krugman is the major proponent, assumes that standard theory has a difficulty that actual competition is not perfect competition, it's imperfect. It therefore situates itself within the problematic of imperfect competition theory and seeks to fill the gap between the theory and empirical evidence by incorporating oligopoly, increasing return to scale, strategic factors. But at the same time, new trade theory, and Krugman is very explicit about this, says that the foundation of trade theory, the correct foundation of trade theory, is the standard theory, comparative advantage, comparative cost. We modify it to allow for some frictions and imperfections, but the principle is absolutely correct. And Krugman is on record saying many times that those people who say that competitive matters, that China is winning because it has lower costs, or Japan or South Korea, don't understand trade theory. If they had any good training in trade theory, they know that competition doesn't matter because free trade will make nations equally competitive regardless of their cost structure and so on. So they are basically ignorant. And he's literally said that, that they don't understand what they're talking about. What that means is that they don't believe what neoclassical theory is saying, and that's a different proposition. So I'm going to skip over a little bit because I don't want to run out of time, but you can go through the basic assumptions of new trade theory, which are always trying to explain the observed patterns by introducing some more factors into the model of degrees of imperfection, like monopolistic market conditions, returns to scale, and so on, differences in knowledge, differences in technology, accumulated institutionalized human knowledge, such as human capital, and changing, therefore, all the models when you add these factors in. Romer does this, Lucas does this, and, of course, Krugman does this. R&D expenditures. The trouble is, and this is pointed out by several authors, that I quote, the models involved in new trade theory, even with a few factors, are extremely complicated in terms of their outcome, potentially generating multiple equilibria and complex patterns of adjustment to and around them. So in the end, the new trade theory provides very few unambiguous conclusions. It is a hodgepodge of little models, all twisted to fit some local facts and then contradicting other things. And moreover, with changes in parameters or changes in circumstances, implying something else. Now, I'm going to argue that the problem is not going from perfect competition to imperfect competition, but rather going back to the notion of real competition and showing that the principle of comparative cost is false. And once you understand that it's false, then you have another principle in its place, which turns out to be absolute cost, which is exactly the principle that Smith and Marx argue for in terms of international trade, and Keynes argues for, by the way, in international trade. So we need to then look at how Ricardo brings the principle of absolute cost, transforms it into the principle of relative cost. Now, Smith, Ricardo, and Marx completely agree that firms are constantly cutting costs, setting prices, and some firms win and some firms lose, so they're losers and winners, that lower cost gives a firm the chance of winning over others, and that all of these are the central selection mechanism. Competition, real competition, is a selection mechanism of capitalism within a country. Adam Smith says, well, the same principle obviously applies to international trade. He says that capitals are located in nations with more efficient and or lower cost methods of production, because these give it an advantage in international trade just as they would in national trade. So the principle there is the principle of absolute cost advantage, not comparative cost advantage. So from Adam Smith's point of view, if I compare two nations and I see that this nation has higher costs in two goods and this nation has lower costs in two goods, then this nation is the only exporter and this nation will be an importer. They will not have one benefit and the other. If these are higher costs here and these are lower costs here, the lower cost ones, adding on the cost of transportation, will be able to ship in the markets here, and the markets here will be flooded by imports, and there will be nothing going the other way because the costs are higher here. Straightforward application of the principle of trade within a nation that Smith and Ricardo and Marx argue for. And Smith goes on to say that the key factor of the employment of capital anywhere within a nation or in activities aimed at trade within a nation or trade between the nation is what he calls the lure of profit. The private profit, he says, is a sole motive which determines the owner of any capital to employ it either in agriculture, in manufacture, or in some particular branch of the wholesale or retail trade. This applies as much to production destined for domestic trade as it is to production destined for foreign trade. The point is, from this point of view, that international trade is conducted by profit-driven exporters and importers, not by nations. Ricardo understood this perfectly well, accepted this point, and begins from this point, in fact. But his goal is to explain how, starting from this point, you end up with a different conclusion. And that's the point I want to make here. He starts by saying, okay, let me start by saying I have two nations, Portugal and England. Portugal, he says, is the advanced country, and England is the backward country in terms of cost. This is a joke from Ricardo. Ricardo was Portuguese born, living in England, and so he deliberately makes his advanced country, Portugal, which is, of course, not advanced in the real circumstance compared to England, and he makes England the backward producer. And he says, okay, let's imagine that Portugal has lower costs than England. So it has two goods, and their costs are lower, and English costs are higher, right? Now, what would happen? Adam Smith correctly says that England will be flooded with imports coming from Portugal because Portuguese capitalists have lower costs. They'll be able to go to the English market, sell there. English capitalists will not be able to come back the other way, except for a few goods. So trade will be very imbalanced. England will run a trade deficit because its markets will be flooded by cheap imports from Portugal. And Portugal will have a trade surplus because it can sell not only in its country but abroad. That's perfectly sensible from the logic of absolute cost advantage. Everybody with me here? Okay. But Ricardo says, now look, if this is the case, England is going to have to spend money to buy this net trade deficit, has to cover it, because it's selling very few goods and is buying a lot, so Portuguese are therefore going to be receiving money. So just as the trade is going this way, money has to be going the opposite way. You have to pay for it. That means that in Portugal, money is entering and England money is leaving. Up to that point, this is the same argument as in Marx and Smith. But then Ricardo invokes the quantity theory of money. And you can see here where there's the solution for him. If money is flowing into Portugal because it's running a trade surplus, its price level would start to rise because according to the quantity theory of money, prices rise if money enters a country. Conversely, in England, as money is flowing out, its prices begin to fall. As this happens, English prices drift downward. This is the hydraulic model of trade from Ricardo. And Portuguese prices drift upward until at some point, Portuguese prices will be higher for one good from England. So Portugal will now have lost its comparative advantage, so it'll have one good left to that it has an advantage in, and England, on the other hand, will have gained an advantage in one good. So now trade can be two ways. The quantity of trade will adjust in such a way, because the money flows will move back and forth, until trade is balanced. Because if it's not balanced, the money flows will move and move the whole spectrum of prices and costs. So therefore, somewhere in the range of the comparative cost, where each good has one price relatively lower. Relatively lower. So let's say that good was in Portugal was wine. Portuguese wine is cheaper than English wine, and cheap Portuguese cloth is cheaper initially. So English is high up here, but as English prices float downward and Portuguese float upward, at some point Portuguese loses an advantage, and that'll be cloth. So England begins to export cloth, and Portugal is left with only the exports of wine. Not because wine is more expensive initially, but because the prices have moved to make it relatively cloth is more expensive, cloth relatively more expensive. So you can see in this hydraulic model, if you think of it as just a ladder of things, the ladder will move up and down until every country begins to have some advantages. Somewhere in between this balance will be a trade balance point. Ricardo is really not concerned about what determines the exact balance point. He's concerned that it falls within certain ranges. And these are the ranges of comparative costs. Now, which good is going to be the one that Portuguese loses first, or England gains first? It's the good in which it has the least disadvantage in England, and Portuguese, the one that it has the least advantage. So Portuguese costs are lower, English costs are higher, but the relative price of Portugal to wine to cloth and the relative price of English wine cloth are in such a range that as these come down, one of them is going to cross over first. And the one is the one in which the least advantage for Portugal disappears first, and the least disadvantage for England disappears first. So the issue is not advantage-disadvantage, it's relative advantage-disadvantage or comparative cost that counts. And you can see this, if you think of this as a hydraulic model, you can see this, that the ones with the least advantage will lose that advantage first as prices rise in Portugal, and the one with the least disadvantage will come into the picture soonest as prices fall in England. So there, Ricardo has proved something fantastic, which is that unlike competition within a country where the cheaper producers will beat out the more expensive producers, between countries, competition will make two different unequal sets of countries equal in terms of trade. They'll make them equally competitive. And that's a quote I read you before, that the expectation of trade theory is that this process will operate through the workings of the market. And because it is through the workings of the market, trade will be balanced across nations roughly. We'd expect it to be, except for fluctuations of some sort, to be randomly around zero. And that's a beautiful argument, really beautiful. And I want to do it again numerically, but I want you to see the logic of it. The same argument operates if we say that instead of prices doing the adjusting, exchange rates do the adjusting. So far, I've been implicitly assumed that exchange rates are not doing the adjusting. But now suppose the same situation. English has higher costs, Portuguese has lower costs. So Portuguese are exporting goods to England and piling up English money. Therefore, Portugal is losing Portuguese money also. Its reserves are declining here, and the reserves of English money are rising. In the foreign trade market, there's a lot more English money looking to be exchanged to bring back the Portuguese money. So the English exchange rate is driven down because there's a surplus of English funds looking to convert. And the Portuguese exchange rate is driven up, exactly the same effect. You have English exchange rate driven down, so the prices in England don't actually change within the country. But in terms of foreign prices, they drift downward. They're translated into lower prices. Portuguese prices don't change within Portugal. But because the exchange rate of Portugal is rising, the foreign trade equivalent of Portuguese prices is rising. And you can see the effect will be that at some point you will again come to where the least advantage is lost in Portugal and the least disadvantage is gained in England through the same mechanism. So it doesn't matter whether the exchange rates are fixed, so the money flows do the work, or they're flexible, so the exchange rates do the work. What matters is in the end, trade will be balanced through the workings of the free market. From this point of view, it doesn't matter whether there's Bretton Woods in the post-war period up to the fall of Bretton Woods in the late 60s, and then it doesn't matter whether there's fixed exchange rates afterwards because trade will be balanced before and after. This is Ricardo's own example. So let us start with a situation in which Portugal, in domestic prices, has exchange rate. This is a symbol I made. This is for the Portuguese escudo, 90, and wine costs 80 in domestic currency. In England, wine costs 90 pounds and 80 pounds. And let's assume, just for the sake of convenience, exchange rate is 1-to-1, right? So the, I didn't say that right. The exchange rate 1-to-1, so if 90 escudos translates into 90 pounds, 80 escudos translates into 80 pounds. Obviously, the number, the exchange rate doesn't matter. And the main point is that these in pounds are cheaper than the British prices in pounds, which are 100 and 120. So it's very clear here that Portugal is dominant in both sectors. Is that point clear? Everybody understand that? This is just a hypothetical initial point. Now Ricardo says, yes, but, why did I go to flexible exchange rates first? Let me do the price levels first. Ricardo says, yes, but in that situation, Portugal will be selling both cloth and wine in England. And as that happens, money is going to flow into Portugal. And as money flows into Portugal, prices will rise. So from the initial prices, prices will rise to, let's say, 103 and 92 in escudos in Portugal, leaving the exchange rate the same. This translates into British pounds, 103 and 0.5 and 92. England's prices are not affected. English prices rather fall by the same movement. Money is moving out of England, so prices fall. So English prices end up at 86 and 103. And the point is that now, suddenly, England has a cheaper commodity than Portugal in terms of international prices. And Portugal retains one commodity in terms of England. And you can see in terms of ratios, you can work out the one that gets lost first to Portugal is the one which it has the least advantage in. The one that's gained first in England is the one that had the least disadvantage in. Okay, do you see the logic of this? So this is a movement through prices. The same movement takes place through exchange rates. Here you start with the initial situation that we had before. Exchange rate is 1. But now, because of the movement of money into Portugal, you have a lot of extra pounds to get rid of in Portugal. And they go on the foreign exchange market. They drive down the value of the pound. Did I do this right? Yeah. So you can get more pounds for the escudo. That means a pound is cheaper. And if the exchange rate goes up to this, then Portuguese international prices will be 120 and 107 in terms of pounds. English prices are not affected by this domestically, neither Portuguese prices domestically. But in the world market, Portuguese prices will now be higher than England in cloth, but still lower than England in terms of wine. So Portugal will have lost one commodity in terms of foreign trade and gained another. So I leave it here because this is the point of departure for every trade theory and virtually every textbook, heterodox or orthodox. This proposition that free trade will automatically take away absolute costs from countries that have too many of them, so to speak, and give cost advantage to countries that have too few until they are competitive, they're equal in the sense of foreign trade. And this is wonderful because nothing has happened in Portugal or England. There's been no changes in production, no efficiency, no wages, nothing. Everything is moved automatically through the foreign exchange market or through the money flows, through inflation. And notice that this is a movement of the real exchange rate because in one case, it's the prices that did the adjusting, and the exchange rate was fixed. In the second case, the prices were fixed, and the exchange rate did the adjusting. Either case, it's the real exchange rate that moves in Ricardo to make it all come out right. Now, this theorem, this assumption has been so powerful that it's taken almost universally to be true by everybody. So naturally, the proper place to ask is, what's wrong with it? And that's what I will begin with next time. I want to show you the same argument as it appears in Marx, actually, in a phrase or two, but the logic of Marx's argument. I want to show you then you get a totally different result. And that result explains the patterns we see, which is persistent trade deficits and persistent imbalances as a natural consequence of international trade. OK? So it's not tomorrow. I said tomorrow, Friday. The makeup class is on Friday. And we'll have one more class on Monday to wrap up real micro from a classical point of view.